Hello, women. You're in for a huge treat. These two are fabulous. Not only you're, obviously I can feel the power. My name is Valerie Pringle. I worked as a broadcaster for a long time, but one of the volunteer jobs I've worked very hard at for the last decade is raising money and improving access to care and awareness in terms of mental health. So sort of why I'm here. But I'm happy to be here because I love these women. As part of my broadcast career, I obviously talked to Silken, Laumann, Olympian, probably the bravest human you would ever know, who catastrophically broke and shattered her leg just before the Barcelona Olympics and came back to win a medal there. An outspoken author and motivational speaker and a real hero to many people in this country. Margaret Trudeau is an icon. You know, we grew up with her when she appeared as this beautiful young woman who married Pierre Trudeau and followed her life and her lovely children and boys, and she wrote books about...
And a girl.
Anyway, she's the mother of our current prime minister. She's an author, and she's starring in a show right now called A Certain Woman of an Age, talking about, again, mental illness, mental health, and her extraordinary journey. I admire them both so much for their lives, for who they are, because they're wonderful women, but for their very public disclosure of mental illness and their public service in getting people to know more and be honest and hear their stories, share their stories. And Silken, to that effect, has just launched a new website called Unsinkable. And that's a story sharing platform, and you'll hear a little bit more about that. So with that, I'm wondering, you know, we'll start maybe at the nadir. Let's start at the absolute bottom, you know. You were this gorgeous golden girl hero, and nobody knew you were a cry for help, truly a cry for help. What happened?
Well, I think like many people in this room, you know, I was an achiever. And, you know, always had to perform at the top of my game. I was a four-time Olympian, a world champion, a mom, a public speaker, somebody that people looked up to. And yet, inside, I was going through hell. And one day, I had a moment in Phoenix, Arizona. I had two kids, 4 and a 6-year-old. We'd gone all day. I was having a business trip, combining a business trip with my kids. Have any of you tried to do that before? And I reached this moment where we came back from the pool and my daughter was, you know, screaming that the tag was bothering her on her bathing suit and my son was wanting to go back on the slides, and I felt absolute rage. I'd never felt this way before. And I thought, this isn't right. I wanted to hurt them. And I left the hotel room with my telephone and I realized I can't do this on my own. And I called my friend Kim Van Bruggen, who's here today, and I said, I need help. It was the hardest thing that I've ever done. I was an Olympic athlete, I was a leader. How can you need help? But it was also probably the most liberating thing that I've ever done, and it literally changed my whole life. Because being public about your story, I mean, we all have stories. Every single one of you have a story, and it's not just what's written on your resume. You've all got really scarily impressive resumes, but we also have our personal stories, and it gave me permission to authentically start telling that story. And before I published my book, I mean, I would have hundreds and hundreds of people tell me about the things they'd overcome in their life because I have this huge scar on my leg and and I had overcome this accident. But after I wrote my book, I started to hear a whole different kind of story, people telling me what they'd overcome with mental health. Mental health affects every single one of us. It affects all of us in this room, whether we're personally affected in our family environment or with our colleagues, none of us are left untouched, and it started that conversation.
And Margaret, for you, I mean, you'd very publicly sought help for postpartum depression years ago, and, you know, had a life where people, you know, had talked to you about maybe, you know, you should get some help and, you know, in the ups and downs. But again, with you, you know, I remember you telling me that you were pretty much lying on the floor of your how
denial is the biggest part, of course, and particularly for high-achieving women who want to be strong, who want to be everything to everyone, to our children, to our mothers, to our and our workplace. We want to be strong. And so denial is a very common thing. That you, my denial phase, unfortunately, lasted 25 years. I did get therapy. I did have treatment. I was even hospitalized. But it didn't take, because I just could not accept that I was seriously ill. I just thought this too would pass. I thought anyone who was married to Pierre Trudeau would go half mad. But that wasn't the truth. The truth was I was bipolar. And I now see it, as I'm sure, Valerie, you do. It's just as clear as day to me. There's two types of bipolar people. There's bipolar untreated, whose lives will be a roller coaster, who their shame for the people they disappoint by not being able to participate when they're depressed, or their crazy actions when they're manic, highest suicide rate of all the mental disorders. So I think that by accepting and not being in denial is the first step. And you didn't stay in denial for very long, so
but
it
you,
sounds like
wasn't.
You said, I've got a problem, I better get it dealt with.
It was hard work.
Yeah, well, because in my case, so I suffer from depression. I had a mom who had serious mental illness that wasn't diagnosed. And I lived in a home where, you know, my mom couldn't be a mom. And I felt that if I was going to open that Pandora's box of the dysfunction, the throwing plates, the screaming, the never knowing what mom you were coming home to, were you kind of come home to that mom who was like sculpting and creative and amazing, or were you coming home to that mom who was drinking a bottle of wine on the couch, ready to, you know, harm you with her words? And so I was afraid, you know, I was afraid. And I also, I don't know, I think a lot of people, you just stuff it down. It's your life. Your family is a sample size of one, right? So you have nothing to compare it to. And I seem to be doing fine, thank you very much, you know, until...
Until you weren't.
Until you're not. I wasn't. And, you know, to your point about, like, finding help, my kids were little, and I realized that if I didn't get help, because I was doing exactly what you were doing, trying to do it all, trying to be there for everyone. You know, women, I mean, men might have this a little bit, but I think women have it in spades, right? You want to keep everybody happy. We are the caregivers, and we have these big jobs, and we have a lot of responsibility. And it was my children. It was realizing that if I didn't get help, I would hurt my children mentally. And, you know, that helped me and motivated me on my journey. Go ahead.
I did start my journey with bipolar with a postpartum depression after the birth of my second son. And I, of course, at that time, I had perfect little Justin, who was 2 and as cute as a button. I had a well-running household. I had quite a glamorous life, if Pierre didn't work all the time. But I woke up a few weeks after having the baby, and I had no more joy in me. And I've always been quite a joyous person. Mm-hmm. I choose joy always over anything else. But the joy was gone. I couldn't make decisions. I didn't know what I should wear, so I would just cancel appointments. And anyway, I couldn't go to the hairdresser because I was too tired, and no, I didn't want to play with the children. Well, Pierre and I saw what was happening, because the only way you really can diagnose it, even understand a mental illness, is through patterns of behavior, how people are acting. And I was not me. And so we went to a psychiatrist in Ottawa, and he... And only Woody Allen sort of went to psychiatrists in 1974, so we were kind of brave. But the psychiatrist just, he was so excited to talk to the Prime Minister, and he turned to me and sort of told me it was what I'd already knew. We all know about fluctuations of emotions. You can have a little baby blues. No, this wasn't baby blues. This was clinical serious depression, which was going to be followed in 4 or 5 months with my first big manic episode. So there was no information. And I found out, found out much later that why we want to get our young girls immediately diagnosed, our young mothers immediately diagnosed, and really be cognizant of their moods. Don't let them put on a mask. Don't really find out how they're feeling. Because Shayla Misery, who's the head of the Women's Hospital, chief psychiatrist there, she was, she's also an expert on postpartum depression. And she said, if you close that neural pathway to depression and with the first episode, you won't relapse again and again and again when things go wrong in your life. And that's my story. I just, things would trigger me into the worst deep depressions, and other things would trigger me into the highest highs. And until I could take it on, until I could accept, and even then I had to have an intervention.
So, but Margaret, what made you better? I mean, you did have to have an intervention. You were hospitalized.
Yes.
And diagnosed.
Dying,
and getting the medication right for bipolar is tricky.
Oh, no, but I've been on it for years, and different consequences, different times. It's really about taking it on. It's hard to describe, but it's just the point when you don't have any choice but to choose to get better and to listen and to take the medication. And, you know, I said this is one of my lines in my play. If you like me and think your body is your temple, get over it. Drugs are good. They really can balance an unsettled brain. They can replenish the hormone. They can
balance. And I think, Valerie, we were talking about this earlier. There is stigma.
Mm-hmm.
Even in today, I mean,
still,
we're from
all
Canada.
Let's talk, you know. It seems every artist, every athlete, everybody's got a story and been public about it. So, you know, where's the shame anymore? I mean, my daughter and I do speeches because she suffers from depression and anxiety. And so that we started doing that a decade or so ago.
But there is still shame.
I never felt ashamed of her.
No, because you're a mom. And you're not ashamed of your children. You see your children in their perfection, as we all should see each other. But, you know, I remember having those conversations even with my husband initially about the fact that I take an antidepressant every single day. And he's like, well, what are you like if you don't take the pill? You know, like I was going to turn into some Jekyll and Hyde thing. And just that education and that feeling that, you know, if you have a mental illness, if you've suffered from mental illness, that somehow you don't have it all together, that you're not as strong, that you're somehow flawed. And for me, you know, I was perceived as this woman with amazing courage and tenacity and strength, you know, and the idea that, you know, that I had a problem, you know, that I was sometimes weak. You know, it was a tough one. And the stigma is very much still out there. As much as we're talking about it, you know, how are we really in our workplaces, for instance, treating mental health issues? Like, are we really treating them the same as somebody who's broken their arm or has chronic migraines? Or no, we're not. We don't have the same kind of benefits. We don't have the same kind of conversations. In the conversations we have with people.
I want to say one thing about that, though, because I do a lot of conferences. We in Canada, and I'm sure it's the same in the United States, a lot of corporations and big businesses have taken on the concept in the last 10 years of social responsibility. And most companies, this is where I do my public speaking, is during Mental Health Week, when they really try and up the ante on every level for people to understand what mental illness is. It's an illness like any other illness. You need to get treatment and you'll have recovery and you'll be back to work. And there is a whole shade of gray, a whole shame pit that we've created over the years from our not understanding what it is. But we know so much more now.
We know more, and there is hope. The one work story I was going to tell is about Catherine, my daughter. And I mean, it's really instructive. And this was a couple of years ago. She was in her early 20s when she had her first episode. She'd gotten a BlackBerry. It was before iPhones even. And she was working on a political campaign here and just was getting more and more panicky. And I mean, that had happened through her life a bit, and I was a clueless mom in the sense, oh, you'll be fine, get through it. Exams at university and crying jags, etc. But, you know, at some point, I found her, you know, curled up in a fetal position on her bed, sobbing uncontrollably. And, you know, it took until then that the penny dropped with me, ashamed to say, you know, she's sick, she's hurting, and she needs help. So she was off work for a bit. And anyway, the relevant story is the night before she was going back, and she was still pretty shaky and a little weepy, and she said to her dad, you know, we were talking, and she, what do I say? Because she'd been off, you know, it hadn't been clear why she was off. She was doing communications on this campaign. And so he said, you know, tell the truth. So she went in the next day, you know, a little trepidatiously, and then ended up speaking to her boss, who said, you know, Catherine, how are you? You know, nice to have you back. You know, what's wrong? And she said, I've been having panic attacks, you know, depression. And in that moment, he said, oh, you know, my wife suffers from that. That's really tough. Well, you know, we'll help you or whatever. And I mean, she said, you know, light bulbs exploding, like, why doesn't everybody tell the truth? Like, if I'm crying in the bathroom, they will not be talking about me. It just changed everything. And the trajectory, I was saying, you know, he didn't go, oh, look, honey, you know, you can't handle this pressure. You can't do this. Maybe you should find, you know, a job in a library. You know, that whole, you know, old junk. But in fact, that boss made all the difference in the world to her at that moment with that reaction. And, you know, she's been great, great ever since. But that was, in terms of a work experience, profound. I mean, have you had people look at you like, oh, on antidepressants?
Yeah, yeah. I think, you know, we started this project, We Are Unsinkable, where we're telling Canadian stories of what they've overcome. And you know, there's a lot of stories in there around mental health, people who've had mental health crises, people who've lost children and have ensuing mental health crises. And they're incredible stories. And we use the lens, are those stories hopeful and helpful? But some people that have written for us have said, like, I'm just thinking of this friend of mine, Mary Del Salvo, and she writes, she's a top insurance agent in Canada for the company that she works for. And she said it was a big decision for her to share her story because she was concerned about the way her colleagues would perceive her. And the day before the story was released, her most senior colleague said to her, are you sure you want to do this? So obviously, there's still stigma out there, or we wouldn't be feeling that trepidation.
But you've been doing this a long time, talking to people for a long time, Margaret. So do you see the dial moving, that people are understanding, or do people still want to hide?
To capsulize what I've seen, in 13 years I've been a mental health advocate, and I've had to learn a lot about how communities react, how families react, what resources are in place. And, you know, we're in a pretty good shape in our country. We have pretty good mental health services across the country, particularly because we have that one Canadian Mental Health Association that's in every town. So there is an opening in it, but we're a long, long, long way from being able to provide the real help. But one of the best things that I have done was when I went into a scene, is when I went into Massachusetts, into Worcester, for an evening. It was a big fancy dinner. It was by an organization called Shine. And it was such a gala. And I was overwhelmed with the subject of this panel, joy, because of their approach. What the hardest thing is to talk about it. So if we want to nip it in the bud with our teenagers, and 1 out of 5 of our children has a mental illness, that's the truth, and only a third of them are even treated.
So and 80% of onset of mental illness.
So when they get into the late teens, in their teens, and there's all that teenage angst and trying to be your own person, and when they don't talk to you at all, whatever, Mom, then you have to, what are you going to do? Well, it's teen advocacy, it's peer advocacy. And what the Shine Initiative is it only costs $3,000 per high school. And when a person has gone through a young man or woman, teenager, has gone through a mental crisis, taken the treatment, followed the, had her battle plan, you know, got through it. When she comes back to school, it's not to hang her head down in shame. She becomes a mentor with a badge on her to let other kids know, you can talk to her, she's been through it. She's had to go on those drugs. She's had to go to the doctor. She was even in hospital. And because of that, because they won't talk to us, I don't know how many of you have raised teenagers, but they really don't want to talk to you. They want to talk to each other. And to get the best information, of course, in the Shine Initiative, which is such a well run little community based operation, they have a real access program of resources and community help, and I think that's what we all want. Mm-hmm. That it's community based, it's in our schools, it's part of us. We're not, because we all, it's to normalize it.
I want to ask you guys one question, or unless you want to say something quickly, we've only got a couple of minutes left. How do you look after yourselves now? What have you learned so that you care for yourself properly and really make sure that you try not to get sick again?
Yeah, so I think the first thing, and this applies, I think, to all of us, whether you've had a mental health issue in your life or not, it's about prioritizing self. We will forever have responsibilities. You know, I every year I say, oh, I'm gonna travel less, but then there's all these great things that come up in my life and these opportunities. I think I could make a difference there, and I make a difference there. I'm traveling 17 days in September and 18 days in November. You know, so prioritizing self. And how many of you are mothers of youngish children, show of hands? Yeah, like almost half of you. So toughest thing for mama to do is to put herself first. Essential. It's looking after yourself that allows you to have the capacity to be terrific in your jobs and to be present with your kids. And when you really get that, without the exercise for me is important. So is meditation, so is yoga. So is actually, for me, the hardest thing is justifying spending time by myself. That's how I regenerate, is by not being with anybody. But if you don't have that, you don't have anything to give. So if you get that one right, like, really ask yourself, what do I need today? And the other part for me is, before saying yes to anything in my life, I ask myself, what am I saying no to? So if I'm saying yes to being part of this conference today, what am I saying no to? And so I'm very conscious and intentional in the choices I make today of how I spend my time.
All right, Margaret, you've got a minute and a half.
Oh boy, I've got a pack.
Come on,
so
a minute
fast.
And a half. How do you look after yourself? You look so fabulous.
All mental illness is wrong thinking. Just figure that out. Whether you're depressed, whether you're manic, whether you're anxious, whether you're full of fear, whether you're paranoid, nobody likes you, whether you're self-loathing, that's wrong thinking. It is not going to help you get to joy. It is not going to make you happy thinking that way. Nobody's happy who's depressed, because their thoughts are so meaningless and disconnected, and the mania is too crazy. There's three things I had to learn to do every single day, and they sound so trite, so banal, and this is why I have the life, the joy, the fun, the work, the grandchildren, everything I have in my life that I never had before. Because being bipolar, there was no balance. There was no consistency. The most important thing you can do for yourself, for your brain, is sleep. You must put sleep number one. While we are asleep, we have 80,000 thoughts a day. That's just ordinary minds. I can't even imagine how many thoughts must go through all of your minds.
All right, look, they're counting down. Two. Number okay. Two.
And then we've got sleep. We've got exercise to make you sleepy, to get your endorphins up. And you have to go outside. You have to have a really good relationship with nature as part of how you eat, how you are, being outside. Mm-hmm. There, nature's a great balancer. So I didn't just go home after getting out of the mental hospital and just go outside and drink a glass of milk. I had to take a lot of pharmaceuticals. I had to take a lot lot of cognitive behavioral therapy to take my angry, fearful, shameful, just humiliated mind and change it into one that's happy, that chooses to find the good things in life, that chooses to be the best, that chooses not to fall again, as you started out. How do we keep out of it? Every single day.
Every single day.
It's done. The end.